non-adiabatic condensation process. Now let us see about forms of condensation. There are usually two types of forms of condensation. One where condensation occurs below freezing point and where condensation occurs above freezing point. This is simply nothing but the dew point which is below freezing point and which is above freezing point. So freezing point of water occurs at 0 degrees Celsius. So above 0 degrees Celsius, water is in liquid form, and below 0 degrees Celsius, it will be in solid form. And when the dew point, that is the saturation point, when it is above 0 degrees Celsius, we see things like dew, fog and clouds, which are in, which have water vapor. Whereas in the other case, when the dew point is below 0 degrees Celsius, so when it is negative, we observe frost, snow and cirrus clouds. Cirrus clouds, as we have seen in the previous video, they are clouds which are at greater heights, just below the tropopause and in the upper levels of tropopause, as well as lower layers of stratosphere. So cirrus clouds are very high clouds and they exist usually in the form of ice crystals. So these are the ones where condensation occurs below dew point, below freezing point, that is 0 degrees Celsius. So we'll see all these in detail. First, let us look at various forms of condensation. The first one is dew. Dew occurs when the condensation or dew point is above freezing point. So here we don't see any formation of ice, and moisture is deposited in the form of water droplets on cooler surface or solid objects. Clear sky, little or no wind, high relative humidity and long cold nights facilitate formation of dew, and dew point should be above freezing point. This is the most important point. So for dew to occur, the condensation or dew point should be above freezing point. So when does dew occur? Usually during long winter nights, we have the surfaces which are very cold. So when the surface is cold, the air above it also is comparatively cooler. So when the air is cold, it facilitates condensation process. This condensation gives rise to dew. So this is about dew. And white frost is the counterpart of dew, which occurs below freezing point. So the only difference between white frost, as we can see in this figure, and dew is that white frost occurs below freezing point and dew occurs above freezing point and white frost below freezing point. So here ideal condition same as dew, except that air temperature must be at or below freezing point. And moisture is deposited in the form of minute ice crystals, and condensation takes place at a dew point which is at or below a freezing point. This is normal. So you can compare dew and white frost. Okay, first let us look at the concept of temperature inversion, which I've explained in detail. But to understand fog, we need to know about temperature inversion. We know that temperature inversion is a condition where we have colder layers which is surrounding the surface of Earth, followed by a warmer layer which is sandwiched between two colder layers. So this is the condition of temperature inversion. So this is important. The concept of temperature inversion is important in understanding the condition of fog. Fog is nothing but a cloud with its base near the ground, and there are different kinds of fog like radiation fog, advectional fog and frontal fog. So fog basically occurs when there is temperature inversion. So if you look at this figure, I've given a detailed account of temperature inversion in my previous video, so you can watch that video to understand temperature inversion. So when this layer is cold, so it is trapped below this warmer layer. As a result, the condensation happens in this colder layer, which is at the surface of Earth. When condensation happens at this bottom layer, it gives rise to fog. So fog is nothing but a cloud with its base at near the ground. So this happens due to temperature inversion. So coming to radiation fog occurs due to excess loss of heat. So when there is excess loss of heat, in such a case condensation occurs, but this is not a significant kind of fog. There is one more important concept called as advectional fog. This is a well pronounced fog which is observed in the regions where cold and warm currents meet. For example, Great Banks in the Canada and other regions like Japan, usually this kind of fog is very significant. And also Benguela Current, and we have Peru Current, all these currents also creates advectional fog. So we can see when there is cold water available at the surface, the air above the cold water becomes significantly cooler because of contact with this cool water. As a result, here also we see temperature inversion. So when there is temperature inversion, the fog or condensation of water droplets occur, giving rise to a low cloud. So this is nothing but advectional fog. This is well pronounced because these cold currents are very comparatively very cool, and hence they can form significant amount of condensation. And again, temperature inversion situation here is here lasts for a very long time, and hence this advectional fog lasts for a very long time. The best example is Great Banks region of Canada. And coming to frontal fog, we have seen about front formation in the previous video, and the fog that is created during front formation is called as frontal fog. We have seen how a colder air mass replaces a warmer air mass occupying this region of a warmer region, and hence we have cold air mass which is surrounded by a warm air mass, and above warm air mass we have a cold air mass. So this is ideal case of temperature inversion. So when there is temperature inversion, there will obviously be fog. So this kind of fog is called as frontal fog. One important point is the visibility in foggy regions is less than 1 kilometer. So if we consider with mist is just another kind of condensation which is quite similar to fog, except that the visibility is greater than 1 kilometer. We can see in mist the visibility is comparatively better, whereas in fog the visibility is very low. Coming to mist is a kind of fog in which the visibility is more than 1 kilometer but less than 2 kilometers. So here visibility is significantly higher than fog. So fog is denser than mist and tends to last longer because of temperature inversion. So fog usually occurs due to significant temperature inversion, whereas mist doesn't need significant temperature inversion. It can occur along sloping surfaces where fall in temperature is substantial. So this thing doesn't last for long, that is mist doesn't last for long, whereas fog lasts for a very long time. Usually mist is observed in regions like South India, where the temperature diurnal temperature range is very low, whereas in North India, that is Delhi and other regions, usually the temperature fall is very significant in winters, and there we see a lot of fog. And another form of condensation is cloud. We have seen how cloud is formed while explaining about latent heat of condensation. So usually clouds are formed when there is upliftment of air. Upliftment of air carries a lot of moisture with it, and this uplifting air carrying moisture accumulates a lot of moisture in the upper levels of atmosphere, that is troposphere, and this condensation process gives rise to a huge cloud. And based on different forms of different levels of condensation, we have different clouds. For example, cumulonimbus clouds is formed when there is significant amount of moisture and wind speeds are very high. And we have nimbostratus clouds, which is quite similar to cumulonimbus, except that here the condensation process extends over a large area rather than significant heights. And there are other kinds of clouds as well, usually based on dust and ice crystals. For example, we have cirrus clouds, which are formed due to ice crystals. So again, these are different forms of condensation. And when condensation happens much above ground, it is called as cloud. So we can see fog here. Fog is nothing but condensation at the ground level. It is nothing but a cloud at the ground level, whereas clouds are at much higher levels. And the most important concept is smog. Smog is essential in terms of environment because smog leads to greater pollution levels in cities like Delhi and Beijing, and it is a very serious problem as it creates a lot of health related issues like lung cancer, etc. So we need to study this in detail. Smog is nothing but smoke and fog. We have seen that in fog we have water droplets which are condensing at the lower layers, and when these water droplets condense along with smoke, in such a situation we see fog, which is called as smoky fog. So smog is nothing but smoky fog. Smog is a combination of airborne particles, matters like soot, invisible toxic gases including ozone, carbon monoxide, sulfur dioxide, and carcinogens. Carcinogens is nothing but cancer-causing agents. So soot, smoke, etc., all these are produced as a result of industrial waste. For example, sulfur dioxide and oxides of nitrogen are produced when coal is burnt, and we have carbon monoxide, which is also produced during the burning process of coal. And ozone is the one which is usually present in stratosphere, and it is a friend if it's in stratosphere but becomes an enemy if it's in the lower levels of atmosphere because it is a greenhouse gas. And again, there are different processes which creates ozone. We'll study in detail. And there are two kinds of smog. One is sulfurous smog and photochemical smog. Usually sulfurous smog has mainly sulfur dioxide, whereas photochemical smog has greater amount of nitrogen oxides. So coming to sulfurous smog, it is also called as London smog. So we know that during Industrial Revolution, there was huge amount of coal production as well as coal burning to drive the industries of Britain. As a result, there was due to this burning of coal, there was huge environmental pollution, which mainly released gases like sulfur dioxide, nitrogen dioxide, etc., along with carbon monoxide. But the release of sulfur dioxide is significant. And when this sulfur dioxide reacts with the water droplets, it gives rise to sulfurous smog. It is also called as London smog because it is first observed in London. So it is caused due to use of sulfur bearing fossil fuels, particularly coal. So burning of coal is the major culprit. And coal was the main source of power in the London during that time. And this type of smog is aggravated by dampness and high concentration of suspended particulate matter in the air. So more suspended particulate matter, that is hygroscopic nuclei, the more will be the condensation process, more and more will be the smog formation. So this kind of sulfurous smog is associated with blue colored skies, as we can see in this figure. It is sometimes called as haze, blue haze. And the next concept is photochemical smog. This is very important. This is caused by burning of large volumes of coal, just like in the other case. And here, mostly vehicular emissions and industrial fumes play a very important role. Again, industrial centers like Beijing, etc., have this significant photochemical smog, which is very dangerous for human health. One important difference between sulfurous smog and this kind of smog is the photochemical smog is significant when it forms due to reaction between pollutants and sunlight. So in the other case, when studying about sulfurous smog, here the reaction in the presence of sunlight is not so significant, whereas in photochemical smog, sunlight is the most important constituent. So without sunlight, these reactions won't occur. So sunlight to form secondary pollutants, usually primary pollutants like sulfur dioxide, nitrogen oxide, carbon monoxide, etc., react with sunlight to form secondary pollutants. And these secondary pollutants in turn react with primary pollutants, giving rise to photochemical smog. And this is aggravated when temperature inversion is significant. Usually smog formation occurs at the time of temperature inversion. We have seen how fog occurs in regions where there is temperature inversion. So when there is temperature inversion, this is significant. So primary pollutants includes nitrogen volatile organic compounds. So all these fossil fuels like petrol, diesel, etc., they are called as volatile organic compounds. And when these interact with sunlight, they produce secondary pollutants. So air pollutants may include aldehydes. Aldehydes are nothing but compounds, organic compounds, which are formed by oxidization of alcohols. And we have nitrogen oxides, which are formed, which are liberated during coal combustion process. And we have nitrogen dioxide, and the same process leads to nitrogen dioxide. And we have peroxyacetyl nitrates, which is also a dangerous constituent. And tropospheric ozone. We have seen that ozone in the upper levels of in the stratosphere is significant, but when it comes to troposphere, it is a very harmful substance. And these harsh chemicals are usually highly reactive and oxidizing. So oxidizing is nothing but rusting. Usually when iron is oxidized, it gives rise to iron oxide, which is a rust, which is harmful for iron. It weakens the iron. Likewise, we have oxidization of various particles, which is nothing but rusting. So it is common in cities with sunny, warm and dry climates. So precipitation reduces and temperature inversion accentuates. So this is the kind of common phenomenon when there is photochemical smog. So usually temperature inversion in itself doesn't support precipitation process. So it will only have condensation, but no significant precipitation. So in regions where there is photochemical smog, we don't see significant precipitations. Usually in India, in Delhi, we see this in winter months, especially in winter months. In China, it is very common in Beijing. So if you look at reactants, we see volatile organic compounds and nitrogen oxide give rise to nitrogen dioxide. It is a primary pollutant. And this nitrogen dioxide reacts with sunlight. So sunlight is the essential component and gives rise to atomic oxygen. See, atomic oxygen is very dangerous because it reacts with oxygen, giving rise to ozone. So this is how ozone is created at the Earth's surface, and this is a greenhouse gas which is dangerous. And this is nothing but ozone is the secondary pollutant, whereas nitrogen dioxide is the primary pollutant. And again, primary pollutants give rise to peroxyacetyl nitrate and various other pollutants. And all these pollutants in the presence of sunlight again gives rise to various components like ozone, peroxyacetyl nitrates and nitrogen oxides, etc. All these are very harmful substances in the atmosphere which give rise to smog. So this is a table which indicates the effects formation and effects of different kinds of pollutants. Coming to nitrogen oxides, they are formed due to combustion of oil, coal and gas. So bacterial action in soil also liberates nitrogen oxides, both NO and NO2, nitrogen oxide and nitrogen dioxide. Forest fires and volcanic action, this is a very important point. Usually these components, nitrogen oxides, are created mainly due to forest fires and volcanic action. This is very, very important point. So when it comes to sulfur, the most important constant is the thing that liberates sulfur is coal combustion. So when we talk about nitrogen oxides, the most important factor is forest fires and volcanic action. So lightning also creates nitrogen oxides. Coming to its environmental effects, decreased visibility due to yellowish color of NO2. So in my previous videos, I've shown in photochemical smog, usually where nitrogen oxides are the major pollutants, we see this kind of yellowish color of cities, atmosphere. So it can suppress plant growth. Here the important point is yellowish color. This is the most important point. And we have volatile organic compounds like petroleum products, which are volatile. That is, they evaporate very quickly. So they are formed due to evaporation of fuels and also incomplete combustion of fossil fuels. So this is very important point. Incomplete combustion is dangerous because it creates volatile organic compounds. And coming to environmental effects, it creates eye irritation, respiratory irritation, and some are carcinogenic, that is cancer causing agents. Decreased visibility during blue brown haze. So this is very important. Decreased visibility due to blue brown haze. So in terms of nitrogen oxides, we have yellowish atmosphere, whereas with respect to volatile organic compounds, we'll have blue brown haze. And ozone is a greenhouse gas formed from photolysis of NO2. We can see photolysis is nothing but synthesis under the influence of sun. Sometimes results from stratospheric ozone intrusions. So this is very rare case, that is stratospheric ozone which intrudes into low levels of troposphere. But the significant one is photolysis. And this will result in decrease in yield crops, usually due to global warming, retards plant growth, damages plastics. So when it comes to the most important points, so these are the important points which are influenced by ozone levels, damages of plastics and breaks down in rubber, rubber cracks, etc. are caused due to ozone. So if you recall, we have yellowish color due to nitrogen oxides and blue brown haze due to volatile organic compounds, and due to ozone we have damages of plastics and breakdown in rubber, important points. And we have peroxyacetyl nitrates formed by reaction of NO2 and VOCs. We have seen in previous reactions. It is the most important property is it damages proteins. So remember this, damage of proteins, damage in plastics and a breakdown of rubber, and then blue brown haze and yellowish haze. So these are very important because they are our topics under environment section in prelims. So this is all about evaporation, condensation and various forms of condensation. So thanks for watching, and if you liked my video, please don't forget to like and share. This is important. Please share with your friends so that it reaches to maximum number of people, and please give your feedback, and don't forget to subscribe. So I'll be posting more videos on geography, and after geography I'll be posting on other subjects as well. So please don't forget.